come before you in your presence this morning by the blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, who is the Lord and King, who died for your people, Father, to bring them new life, to bring them into your new family. Father, I thank you for music. I thank you for your name. I thank you for the truth that unites us and makes us one. And Father, we thank you for your word. And God, now may you open the eyes of our hearts, Lord, to be enlightened by eternal truth that is ours in your Son that never changes because of your faithfulness and your power. God, enable me to speak in a way that makes it possible for everyone to hear. May your Holy Spirit fill me, Lord, and preach my sermon through me, that you might be glorified in all things. And this we ask in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Good morning. We're back going through Ephesians again. We come now to chapter 4. And as a consequence of God's great plan of salvation and our new identity in Christ, the body of this new Adam, Paul begins to instruct us now as this new humanity on the basis of who they are, right? Chapters 1 through 3, he calls them to a new life that honors and proclaims who they are in chapters 4 through 6. So he goes from this is the new humanity to the standards that are expected of the new humanity. Paul is going to make it very hard in Ephesians, very hard for pretenders and donors and fans of Jesus to feel comfortable. Paul is going to make it very difficult to stay disconnected from what he's called the people of God to in Jesus Christ. I read a quote this week. Somebody sent it to me, a guy named Burke Parsons, and he said this, and I thought it was obviously very timely, but it's very powerful. Listen to these words. He says, many Christians are only concerned about radical Islam when they should be even more concerned about complacent, nominal Christianity. That's powerful, and it's true. It's very easy, very natural to get caught up in what's going on around us, which displays what our hearts truly value. What do we want the most? Because we know that by what we feel most threatened by. And Christians in America are very threatened, and not like without reason, but we're very threatened by the idea of radical Islam because we're very threatened about losing our country. And I'm not saying that's an insignificant issue. What I am saying is that there are things, because we've been called into this new family in Christ, that are much more important than our freedom or anything that goes along with it. Paul doesn't write to us as citizens of the world. He writes to us as citizens of heaven who live in the world. And so the things that Christ has called us to, what do we make of those? What place do those hold in our lives? Do we put the call of Christ alongside every other thing we value and want in our lives? Or does the call of Christ determine all the other values and priorities in our lives? And we learn as we go into chapter 4 now, as we move from indicative, this is what is true, to imperative, because of what is true, this is what you should do. The defining characteristic of this new humanity is unity, oneness in Christ. It's the first and essential byproduct of the common faith we possess. Paul says we're called to maintain it. He urges them above every other call to give attention to the pursuit of unity, of oneness. And so that brings us to the text. Let's walk through it together. The first three verses of chapter 4, Paul's actually going to tell us right away how to maintain unity. I, therefore, a prisoner for the Lord, urge you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which you've been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. Therefore, it's the first time we see that word in Ephesians. We know that the focus of the letter is changing, and there are two reasons for therefore, for Paul in chapter 4, verse 1. There's the immediate reason, which is the last verse in chapter 3, now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or think, according to the power at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever, amen. I, therefore, so Here is how God would be glorified in Christ in the church. Here's the first thing, the most important thing, but also the broader context for therefore is everything Paul has set up to this point in Ephesians. He's proclaimed this great sovereign God who redeems sinners, rebels through Jesus Christ, who secures a new family for himself, his new dwelling place on the earth that he's called and redeemed to proclaim his glory and blessed with every spiritual blessing in Christ. All of that, because of that, therefore, he urges them as a prisoner. Right? Remember, he's under house arrest. Paul is most likely at this point literally chained to a Roman guard who has to go with him everywhere he goes. And so Paul is writing as a prisoner who's under arrest, who's in prison for the sake of this new humanity he's telling them about and calling them to live as a part of. That's why he's in jail, because that's how worth it this vision of a new humanity is. And then now come the exhortations in the second half of the letter. This new identity then precedes new behavior, doesn't it? We don't work into our Christian identity by behaving. It's because we are what we are in Christ that we're called to do what we're called to do. If we ever get those backwards, we ruin salvation by grace through faith alone. The first thing is to maintain unity within this newly created body of believers. He urges them to walk worthy of the calling to which they've been called. Well, how do you do that? How would a human being who's been redeemed without money, without price, on sheer grace, how do you walk worthy of a calling like that? How do you live worth it? How does your life display that this is what has happened to you? And the first thing Paul says that displays it in Ephesians is to maintain unity. Live in a way that honors the fact that God has called you by sheer grace into his family. How do I do that? By pursuing unity as a part of this new family. What is unity? Where does it come from? Paul says it's lived out through five very specific traits: humility, gentleness, patience, mutual understanding of one another, and love. This is very interesting. We'll dig into those in a few minutes, but isn't it interesting that Paul does not start with structures as the way we get to unity? He starts with the conditions of the heart. So he assumes that the biggest threat to unity is inside of us, not outside of us. So he doesn't say the way you're going to get to unity is by structuring your church to do these kinds of things, and if you have these kinds of programs and these kinds of ministry, then you'll get unity. He does not start there. He's not demeaning those things, that there can't be structures. Of course there's structure. Or there can't be ministries. Of course there will be ministries. But those are not the path to unity. They are the result of unity. Unity starts here in each and every single one of us. The biggest threat to unity looks at me in the mirror every morning. The biggest guarantee of unity looks at me in the mirror every morning. Paul starts with the heart. He doesn't start with structures. He doesn't start with things. We always think that that's the way we get to what God has called us to, by designing and implementing and coming up with things. And if we do these things, then we'll have unity. If we don't do these things, we can't have unity. And Paul doesn't even mention those things. Paul says unity depends on this. Maintaining it depends on this. Depends on the condition of my heart, the kind of personality I have. Unity is the product of the Holy Spirit who builds us together, is building us together in chapter 2, verse 22. The Holy Spirit is bringing us together. We're not called to create unity. We're called to maintain unity. We're going to dig that out a little bit later on, but we're not called to create it. We're called to maintain it in the peace we have with God in Christ. So we are not called then, as the body of Christ, as individual members of it, we're not called to a private relationship. There's no place for such a thing. We are called as individual people into life in community, into being part of a body. There's no Christianity without that. We're called to display then what enhances a life together, not what damages it. Unity and peace are two of the main things Christ bought with his blood. For us to be called to maintain unity, to be urged to pursue it, is because we don't want to act like the price that Jesus paid to buy it is unimportant or not worth it. Unity and peace are two of the main things he bought for us. It's an absolute necessity then to preserve what was purchased at so high a cost. How to maintain unity, but why to maintain unity? That's the second part of the chapter. Why is it that unity is so important? What is it about unity? What's the big deal? Everybody's different, right? We're going to have differences. We're going to disagree. Why is unity such a big deal? That's verses 4 through 6. There is one body and one spirit. Just as you were called to the one hope that belongs to your call. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all who is over all and through all and in all. So what's the specific reason that we are called to be one? Because our God is one. That's the first and primary reason. We are the image of God. We are called to reflect God. And the reason we are called to be one, and it's so important for us to be one, is because our God is one, which leads to a very clear rationale for us then. Be one because you are one. You are being built together into a dwelling place for the Lord, not tons of dwelling places. You're being built together in chapter 2 into one dwelling place in the Lord. Be who you are is the call to unity. A fractured church cannot display a unified God. A fractured church cannot display a unified God. There are seven ones in verses 4 through 6. There are seven of them because he wants to drive home with the repetition of that word the reality of our unity. One Father creates one family. One Lord Jesus Christ creates one faith. One Holy Spirit creates one body. There is one baptism, that is, there's one rite, R-I-T-E, that demonstrates our entrance into this family. And it's this truth that demonstrates the one hope that belongs to our call. All of that comes from him. It's based on him that Jesus has accomplished this for us and will see it through to completion in us. There's one hope for us. All Christians everywhere, regardless of culture, national identity, any of these things, class, all Christians everywhere have at least these seven things in common. No exceptions. No exceptions. Which proclaim the truth of the gospel of our one God, who Paul decides to describe here as over all and through all and in all. The God that is the source of all of this in us and in the world is sovereign, Paul is saying. He is omnipotent. He's big. He's present. All of it is under him. There's oneness in our God. Therefore, even though he is three in one, he is one. And by being one, we reflect him. And by refusing to be one and doing what keeps us from being one, we disobey and rebel against him. And so that brings us to what we've been called to, beloved. We've been called to unity. And if we were going to take, again, if we were going to try to summarize in a sentence or two exactly what Paul is saying here, we would say it like this. We could say it like this. Because of what God has accomplished for you in Jesus. Because of what God has accomplished for you in Jesus, you are called to live a certain way, worthy of the fact that you've been called into this family. And this is how you do that. You live in complete humility, gentleness, patience, mutual understanding, and love, all the while eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. The God who saved you is one. Nothing will proclaim him more clearly than the oneness of his new family. That was a little longer than one or two sentences, so let me say it again. Let's summarize Paul's thought here, or try to. Because of what God has accomplished for you in Jesus, it's the main thing to remember. You are called to live a certain way, worthy of the fact that you've been called into this family. And this is how you do that. You live in complete humility, gentleness, patience, mutual understanding and love, eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. The God who saved you is one, and nothing will proclaim him more clearly than the oneness of his new family. So the first thing to take from this as being called to unity is this. We are called to unity because it is the will of our Lord Jesus, the head of the church. We are called to unity because it is the will of our Lord Jesus, the head of the church. I want you to listen to something from John chapter 17. If you want to turn there, you can. This is Jesus Christ praying the night before he died. This is called the high priestly prayer of Jesus. This is him praying, and this is the end of that prayer just before he's betrayed and arrested. In verse 20, praying to his Father, Jesus says, and by the way, very few of the prayers of Jesus are recorded, even though we know from the Gospels that he prayed all the time. God wanted us, just like when we see Paul praying, God wanted us to hear the words of Jesus in this prayer. So this prayer is massive for you and I. Listen to your Lord pray for you. I do not ask for these only, his 12, but also for those who will believe in me through their word. That's you and I. That they may all be one, just as you, Father, are in me and I in you, that they also may be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. The glory that you have given me, I have given to them, that they may be one, even as we are one. I in them and you in me, that they may become perfectly one, so that the world may know that you sent me and love them even as you loved me. Of everything for us in our lives that Jesus could have prayed for, the one he voiced was our oneness, which is precisely as Paul moves from this is what is true to this is what you should do, Paul picks up on that same theme. The oneness is not... Beloved, unity is not something that if you get everybody to get along, you can have, and it's really nice, but it's really not in the cards. No, 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 we are called to it. Jesus prayed for it, and the prayer of a righteous man avails much. Nobody was more righteous than Jesus. His prayer will be answered in the church. It's not an option. It's not like, well, we can have unity if that guy quits disagreeing with me all the time. We can have unity if those people decide to pick up on what I prefer and what I like, then we can have unity. But until then, if I don't get my way, I'm leaving or I'm going to be rotten to everybody. I'm going to cold shoulder everybody if I don't get my way. Why don't we just spit on Jesus while he's praying then? Of all that he could have prayed for, he chose unity. He prayed for vertical unity. Do you notice that? The unity between us and the Father and the Son, because they're one. But he also prays for horizontal unity, the unity between his followers. And here's the thing to realize here, although it's not immediately for us in Ephesians, in this little text, is that as unity is pursued and realized in the church, which it is meant to be, the effect of that is felt by those outside of the church. Twice Jesus mentions that our oneness is how the world will know. There's not another way. Our oneness, which is not a fake veneer, our oneness, which is rooted and grounded in love, by your love for one another, they will know that you belong to me. Well, this is the same expression. By your oneness, they will know that the Father sent Jesus into the world. The unity of the church is the foundation of the witness and mission of the church. Which is why our mission and witness is generally so small, because we don't have oneness that is really rooted and grounded in love. We don't spend enough time together for that. We don't put a priority on it. We gather once a week as a family. Is it a priority for you? You cannot be engaged in the mission of God while simultaneously being insistent on your own way. The insistence for your own way fractures the witness of the church. So we must see that, we must learn to see the church through the lens of the purpose God created it for. Because if we don't, we're going to see it through the lens of what we want it to be, and we'll kill unity, and as a result, kill our witness. It's really hard to invite broken people into a broken and fractured and disagreeable family. In our love for one another, they will see his love or not. So to cultivate unity, beloved, first and foremost, we must have the heart of Jesus. Which brings us to the second point, that we are called to cultivate personalities that lead to unity. We are called by the Word of God to cultivate personalities that lead to unity because of what God has done for us in Christ. Which means unity is going to take engagement. Right? The reason, I hope you see how big of a deal oneness is, because our God is one. So it's a very important thing, which is why Paul grounds it the way that he does. That's why he urges and he says eager, and it's why he puts it as the very first thing, because our natural tendency is not towards unity and the selflessness that leads to it. Our natural tendency is towards self-centeredness, which is the very root of divisiveness and why there is ever any conflict in any context. That's the word of God from the book of James, chapter 4, verses 1 and 2. Why are there fights and quarrels among you? Why are you fighting? Why is there disagreement in any relationship, any context, any people in the world? And he answers it, because your passions are at war within you. You want and do not have, so you covet. You desire and cannot get, so you quarrel and murder and gossip and all these things. Self-centeredness is the root of divisiveness, and that's our natural bent. We will always put a premium on our own opinion and our own preference. That's natural. That's who we are. But now the person that we were born as no longer exists. We've been brought into a new family. If we believe in Christ for our salvation and He is our Lord, we've been brought into a new family. We've been given a new identity. I understand that, well, that's just the way I am. Look, I have all kinds of weaknesses in me that are damaging to unity, that make unity hard. I can be a hard guy to get close to. So I'm not saying that, like, it's just you or so. No. We all have things in us that hurt unity. The problem is that we don't put a premium on what God puts a premium on. So we come to grips with who we are and we like it and we don't want to change. And the older we get, the harder it is to change. This is who I am. That's right. But you've been redeemed. The you that exists needs to die, not get fed all the time. Right? We've been called to something bigger than ourselves. Be commanded. Here's one of those commands that it's just impossible, which is why, thank God, this was all grounded in prayer in 14 through 21 of chapter 3. Remember, we're coming out of, he's prayed for God's power to be at work within us, for us to be rooted and grounded in love, for Jesus to reign over every area of our lives, so that this is what can happen. So the ground of these commands is always the gospel, but we've been commanded here to feel eager. You notice that in verse 3? How does God command feelings? Because God is in control of your feelings. You just have to recognize that in your life. Just because you feel it doesn't mean it's right. We have to feel eagerness to maintain unity. That has to be something that in our hearts we're always going, man, how do I contribute to unity here? How do I help keep oneness? How do I bring us together? How do I keep things from being fractured? What can I do? We have to feel eagerness to maintain this unity. And I think what Paul is saying is that whether or not we're eager, a way to look at ourselves and let the Holy Spirit begin to work is to say, am I eager to maintain unity by cultivating these five traits he mentions? Right? Do I have an eagerness in me? Because unity is the result of a heart that's broken before Jesus. That's where unity is going to come from. And that's manifested by what? By humility. This blessed, what's a way to define humility? Blessed self-forgetfulness. Gentleness, not weakness. Not weakness. Strength that is colored by love. Strength that is colored by love. Humility, gentleness, patience. Patience, man. Patience is worth its weight in gold. Patience, he says. Why? Because bearing with one another in love is going to take a little bit of patience. Some people are easy to bear with in love. Some people are not easy to bear with in love. It doesn't matter, though. If everybody was very easy to bear with in love, first of all, the command wouldn't exist. We wouldn't need to bear with people that are easy to be around. So again, we're going to lead into this. God is not calling us to uniformity. That's not unity. That's the world's vision of unity. Think the same way or we'll burn our town down. That's the new thing. We lost, right? You're going to hear about it. We're going to protest rights we already have, right? So God, that's not what God is after. The world can do that. You can pull that off in your own strength. In the body of Christ, God's not interested in what we can pull off by our own strength because we're testifying to Him, not to ourselves. Bear with one another in love. Bear each other's burdens, Paul says in other places. What does that mean? It means pick them up and carry them yourself. Bear their burdens. Nothing is more important to do for one another than pray, but you can do more for one another. Bear with one another. Pick up other people's burdens for a while. Carry them. Don't just get frustrated with them because them having this burden might make your life difficult and they might be calling a lot and they might be getting on your nerves and they might need you a lot. Bear with them in love, Paul is saying. Bear with one another in love. It's going to take effort to maintain, which in the Christian world means it's going to take prayer. If we want unity, we're going to have to rub some skin raw on our knees. And not just for other people, for ourselves. For ourselves. Carnality and ego, they are rampant and they are killers of unity. And the tragic thing is that we tend to get so accustomed to our flesh that we can let the things that hurt unity fester for years in a church. And not even notice that we're not salt and light anymore. Cultivate traits that will stifle division and conflict. Don't feed what tends to cause problems unless it's the truth. And the truth will always cause problems. But that's not what Paul is talking about here. Cultivate traits that will stifle division and conflict. Pray for God to reveal the things in you that may not contribute to unity. Ask Him to reveal those things. Ask Him to make them known to you. And what's the surefire way to seeing our sinfulness for what it is to recognize our calling for what it is. That sheer grace is how I got into this family. A constant going before the cross. A constant realization and recognition of the centrality of the gospel in our lives and the bigness of the fact that I was redeemed when I should have been destroyed, that will steadily diminish self-importance like nothing else will. That's why there are three chapters of gospel before there's one single command in Ephesians. Let our self-importance be steadily diminished for the sake of the glory of God and His people. Let us foster the heart conditions that are so crucial to humility. That's what Paul is saying. Let us feed that inside. Peter O'Brien says, we are a society of pardoned rebels on whom God has showered favor. So where would self-importance come from in a body like that? How could anybody in a family that's been created by grace think that their way and their opinion and their preference is more important than another's? How could that ever happen if we're clearly recognizing that we've been called into this family by grace? Every problem goes back to being a gospel problem. If we can't see others as more important than ourselves, it's because we aren't seeing clearly the reality of our calling, which is why he talks about our calling so much in the front part of chapter 4. Where is the basis for the self-centeredness that divides us if we've been called into this family by grace? Where is it coming from? Thirdly then, so we're called to unity because it is the will of our Lord Jesus. We are called to cultivate personalities that lead to unity. And thirdly, we are called to authentic unity, not false uniformity. We're called to authentic unity, not false uniformity. Our unity is based on the objective reality outside of us of what God has called us to in Christ. Our unity is not based on ourselves, which is why God can command it. It's not based on us. It's not based on what we have in common. The less we have in common with one another, the brighter and more on fire our unity would be, which is why God tends to put in one place a bunch of people that don't have tons in common and wants them to break out of the circles in which they do, because hanging out with and having life and doing life with people that aren't like you says something much bigger about what Jesus has done. Paul's unity is for a new humanity, right? Paul's unity transcends the kind of unity that is achieved in every other human network that's united around a common cause. That's not what the church is. The church is not just another group united around a common cause. The followers of Satan can pull that off and do every day. This is a vision for something much deeper. This is something that comes from God. This is something that is created by His Holy Spirit, not by us, not by our ingenuity, not by what we have in common, not by the fact that we've decided not to be real with one another and live fake so that we can have a false unity. When you're protesting something, you don't have to have any affection for the person next to you. You're united by that cause. You're not united with each other. And the only thing that does unite you is the fact that you're united around that cause. This is something much deeper than that. God has called us to something we can't do. God has called us to something supernatural, not natural. This comes from God. It's created by His Spirit. And so what happens is we're tempted to overlook what can hurt that kind of unity. We're tempted to overlook the heart issues in one another and in ourselves in a quest to simply get along with one another. That's when we think we've attained unity, when we're not fighting. That's a veneer of unity. It's not what our Lord intended at all. His cross can buy more than that. We're united around a common faith regardless of our differences and difficulties. That's why Paul goes where he does in verses 4 through 6. That verses 4 through 6 are the reason for 1 through 3. It's like that's why he's saying there's oneness. We want to push for uniformity. Let's be honest. Uniformity is easier. Doesn't mean I have to die to anything inside. It's much more controllable. And to be honest, if we're honest, uniformity lets us squeeze other people into our mold so that they're easy to deal with. So that the idols in my heart that are threatening to actual unity never get addressed. Right? We want to make everybody like us, then they'll be easy to deal with. As though we're easy to deal with. Extroverts always want to make introverts extroverted. It's maddening. It's not a sin to be an introvert. It's not a sin to be an extrovert, but I'm checking. I'm kidding. Relax. I'm kidding. But no, we try to squeeze other people into our mold because that's what we want. That's what would make unity easy, is if we get uniformity. Christ is not calling us to that. I'm going to tick somebody off, okay? I don't know who. I just know I'm going to tick somebody off, so... Okay. The book, The Five Love Languages. Beloved, that is, you scratch my back, I'll scratch yours, and we'll get along. Completely bypasses the idols of the heart. Completely bypasses it. You know what? My love language, I like getting gifts. No way. I feel more loved when you give me things. Stop it. Stop. You want... That's what's wrong. You want. Give. And so that's how we think. This is how we can get along if you do what I want you to do. That's a Christian book. Beloved, the problem is in here. And Christ has the power to change you. Christ has the power to kill the idols in your heart that make love and unity and harmony so difficult. We are not who we used to be. Just because I have a natural tendency towards something doesn't make it right or justified or noble. That's liberalism in society that we've embraced in the church. My opinion is valid because it exists. No, it isn't. Truth is valid. Opinions are worth nothing. Truth is valid. We have learned to get along without ever actually being real with each other. So our love is thin and our harmony is thin. That's why it's so easily broken. Right? That's why the fights can do so much damage so fast, because we've never gotten real with each other. And of course that takes work and it's hard and it can cause problems in relationships. But beloved, Isaiah 53 said that Jesus Christ would look on the travail of his soul and be satisfied. What Christ can produce in you is worth every minute of trouble that gets you there. Whether or not we believe that is whether or not we believe he's a sweet and good Savior. This is real talk, gang, real talk. We have to get past this thin veneer of uniformity in all our relationships. In all our relationships. It's not okay to just find a way to not fight with people you're in close community with. That's not unity. That's not going to show the world anything. And the whole point of it is that they would know God sent. How does our unity make the world know that God sent Jesus? Well, it does. We want authenticity in relationships, beloved. We want authenticity. That's when unity can shine. It's not what we have in common that's the basis of our unity, like other groups. It's not that. It's outside of us. The truth we confess that is changing us is the foundation, the basis of our unity. And it never changes, so the unity should always be there, right? The unity should never be dependent on what I'm feeling, right? Unity is dependent on the truth that is making us, that's outside of us. And if we believe the gospel is like that, that will affect our marriages and our relationships with our kids and our relationships with our employers and our employees. The gospel will transcend all of those and begin to work through all of those. And the way it does it in the church is by Christ calling us to these five personality traits that will lead to unity. Why? We are humble because Jesus humbled himself. We are gentle because Jesus would not break a bruised reed. We bear with one another because Jesus bore with us. Jesus carried our burden on the cross. We act in love because even when we were not lovable, Jesus loved us. He is the basis in the gospel of everything we're called to in every relationship. And as his people, it's of primary importance because this is the vehicle God has chosen to show the world who he is and that he sent his son. So we can't put too high a premium on it. Our God, to be divided is to say that God has not done enough to provide for unity. That's what we're talking about here. Our God, beloved, he is three in one. There is one God, and he has made himself known in three distinct persons: God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. They are one in essence, fully God. Yet God is one. It is a mystery we cannot comprehend. But in that oneness, what is there, beloved? There's not uniformity. There's diversity. God is one, and yet God the Father is the one that redeems and calls us forth into his family. The one day God may be all in all. Jesus Christ, the Son, is made Lord to the glory of God the Father. The Son is the one who comes and does the work of redemption and carries it out and intercedes for us. The Holy Spirit is the one who abides with us and rests in us and testifies to Christ, bears witness with our spirit that we belong to him. So even though they are one, there is difference and diversity in function. There is not uniformity. The Father is not the Son. The Son is not the Spirit. The Spirit is not the Son, right? So there's unity, there's oneness, yet in diversity. We're called to reflect a God like that. That we're so one, you could never get us apart, but we're all different, and yet we are one in perfectly grounded love. It's unity in diversity. We reflect our Father then as His new sons and daughters. Listen to this quote from a man named P.T. Forsyth. This is very good. The unity of the church rests on a basis not subjective, but objective. It does not stand on Christian sympathies and affinities, but on divine deed and purpose. It rests upon God's grace and gospel, not on fraternal love, which God will see to if we see to His grace. Our love of each other is the effect and expression of our love of Him who gave Himself for us. This is in opposition to the modern desire for fellowship, comradeship, and brotherhood as the direct constituent of a church. Of course, there is no true church without fellowship and brotherhood, absolutely. But it is not on that that it rests, but on the redemption, the new creation. Fellowship is a fruit and not a root. Beloved, fellowship is a fruit of unity. It's not the root of unity. That's so important because we press. We want unity to stay outside of us, outside of my heart, and into the realm of ingenuity. Which brings us to the last point. We are not called to create unity, but to maintain it. We are not called, if you'll notice in the text, to create unity, but to maintain unity. That's foundational to what we're talking about here this morning. Verse 3, eager to maintain unity. So we're not called to create unity. We're not called to make unity happen. Do you notice that? That's not what we're called to do. We're not benefactors, beloved. We're beneficiaries. We're not called to create unity, to maintain unity. So in other words, what we are called to work on to get to unity is ourselves, not unity. Right? I'm not called to work on unity. That, again, that puts it outside of me. And Paul is saying it's impossible to structure and get to make unity a thing to work for, which is what we tend to do with everything distinctly Christian in our lives. We tend to make it a thing that you have to work for. When we do that, it falls into the realm of technique and strategy and human strength and human wisdom. It becomes something we can pull off, which is why we never have achieved authentic unity. We want it outside of ourselves. We want it as a thing you can check in and check out of. I will go to the fellowship dinner at 6 o'clock on Wednesday and I will do fellowship. Done. Unity done. I'm good. Which is fine to go to a dinner. Please, please, I'm not saying that. You know I'm not saying that. But it completely, to put it outside of us and say, it's a thing to work for, which that's what we do. Everything God has called us to, we say, okay, I'm supposed to be pure. All right, take it out of the gospel and say, I have to be a pure person. How can I be pure? I'll do this, 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 this. According to the power at work within us. That's, beloved, to put it outside of us completely removes responsibility from the individual for unity. And Paul says the responsibility to maintain it is in the individual. The individual doesn't create unity. It's not, we're not responsible for creating it. We are responsible for maintaining what we've been given. We are stewards of the oneness of God in our church. Don't let it become a thing we can perform, because then you don't have to pray for power to realize it. And that's why, beloved, no matter how together a church pretends to be, at the first sign of disagreement or it's not going to go my way, people bail and go to another one. If you had unity, that would never happen. We're not looking for the veneer. We're not looking for uniformity. We've not been called to that. That doesn't say anything about God to the world. We need a unity displayed in such a way that only God can take credit for it. The primary threat to unity then, beloved, is not the structure. It is the heart. It is the heart. Let a desire to do things come from a heart that's broken for people, not from a sense of, we have to do something. We don't even know the reasons. We just, yeah, you have to do, you have to do, you have to do. Because you can't get this without that. And the Bible says, no. The first place to start is here. Right here. Am I humble? Am I gentle? Do I bear with people that I don't agree with in love? Right? Am I eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace, which will be displayed in how I push for my own way or not? What am I eager for? What I want or unity? The eagerness to maintain it is commanded of us, and many factors corrupt it and destroy it. There's a reason for urge. There's a reason for eager in this text, and the reason is our hearts. So we are called to unity because it is the will of our Lord Jesus. We're called to cultivate personalities that lead to unity. We're called to authentic unity, not false uniformity. And lastly, as I said, beloved, we are called. I lost my notes, didn't I? We're called not to create unity, but to maintain it. And so let me conclude saying these last few things. That the main point, I think, of the text this morning is this. Genuine unity is the defining characteristic of God's renewed humanity. Genuine unity, that's why it's first, is the defining characteristic of God's renewed humanity, the church. Our deliberate pursuit of it is part of our recognition of and submission to God's design that everything will one day be united under His Son. Everything. Chapter 1, verse 10 of Ephesians. Our coming together under Christ, our deliberate pursuit of that is part of our recognition of and submission to God's design for all things. And so the question I pose to you this morning is this. Is the condition of your heart, contributing to or preventing unity from being realized in our church? Is the condition of your heart contributing to or preventing unity from being realized in our church? What do you need to die to in order to purposely pursue what Jesus has called you to as a part of this body? What do you need to die to in order to purposely pursue what Jesus has called you to as a part of Gateway? And I just want to tell you, beloved, the same God who calls us to maintain this unity He's provided for us has the power in Christ to deliver you now and in process always from all the things inside or outside of us that keep us from unity. Our hope for a changed heart is the gospel. Our hope is to have enough of ourselves cleared away that we can start to be who we are in Christ. We are and will always remain completely reliant on the working of His power in us, which is what He prayed for at the end of chapter 3. And the fact that God has offered us His power to have that at our disposal is the proof of His commitment for this to be realized in our lives. Beloved, we are the point of light in this world. We are where God is breaking into this fractured society. Think of our world right now. Think of just the United States right now and consider how bright a light would be if there was authentic unity in this world, in this culture, in this town that's very clearly divided by railroad tracks. Beloved, we are the point of light, and Christ has made us new. Let's pray. Our Father, we thank You for Your Son, Jesus Christ, for His grace and His mercy and His reconciling power. And Lord, we have been called this morning by Your word to be eager to maintain the unity that You've bought for us with the blood of Your Son, Jesus Christ, and maintain by Your Holy Spirit. Father, give us the grace to maintain it here by broken hearts. This I ask in the name of Your Son, Jesus. Amen.
Thanks again for joining us. And if you have any questions about today's recording, Gateway Church, or what it means to follow Jesus Christ, you can reach us through the contact section of our website, gwbrawley.org.